The body and the mind work together and depend on each other, so they both need attention. There's a Bible phrase that says, treat your body like a temple. So just put it in your notes, body like temple. Not a bad suggestion. Treat your body like a temple, not a woodshed. Now, in taking care of the physical, we must learn to be conscious of ourselves, but not self-conscious. We need to be aware of our physical appearance, our physical well-being, but not to the point of being self-conscious. We need to be aware, we need to take care, but some people devote too much of their day to physical appearance. Physical appearance is going to have something to do with your future, your well-being, your income, so do spend some time on physical appearance. How we appear to other people does make a difference in terms of our acceptance and our ability to function and do well in the marketplace. In fact, there's another Bible phrase that says, take care of the outside for people and take care of the inside for God. People look on the outside and God looks on the inside. Now, you might believe that people shouldn't judge you by physical appearance. Well, let me give you a clue. They do. Make sure you don't order your life based on shoulds and shouldn'ts. You'll always be confused and you'll always have trouble. The best thing to base your life on is reality. What people really do. So since people generally judge by appearance, then that's probably one thing we want to take care of. That's just part of the game. Now, of course, when people get to know you, or if they've been around you any length of time at all, they're going to judge you by more than appearance. But sure enough, people at first are going to take a look. So taking care of yourself in personal appearance is a consideration. Now, physical development also includes your good health and your well-being. You've got to spend some time on that so that you feel good in the marketplace. Get involved in some form of disciplined exercise. Keeping fit and feeling good has a positive effect on your attitude, not just your appearance. Even if you're not into sports, there are some cassette programs and books on how to stay in excellent shape in only 20 to 30 minutes a day. Get the tapes and find your best way to stay physically fit. Just develop a bit of consciousness about taking care of yourself physically. Physical fitness pays great dividends in terms of your energy level, your ability to live a long, healthy life, and your general sense of well-being. The other part of physical well-being is nutrition. There are some excellent cassettes and books on this subject for you to investigate as well. Do all you can to stay fit, to stay healthy, and to stay well, because physical health and fitness affect how you feel about yourself and how you perform in the marketplace. When you feel good about yourself, other people will feel good about you too. Appearance, vigor, vitality, and well-being have a lot to do with how your life works out. That's the physical side. Now, the mental exercise and nourishment are just as important as physical and spiritual exercise and nourishment. You want to make sure that the acceleration of your mental health, mental well-being, and mental capacity keeps up with your physical capacity. So make sure at 40 that your mind has kept up with the passing of the years. Don't stay 30 at 40. Don't stay 30 at 50. Keep up the learning curve with mental exercises. It's so important for you and me to be stretched beyond where we are. It's too easy to just comfortably sit and stop growing. It often doesn't seem to be that necessary to make the push, to make the effort to learn and to grow and to challenge yourself. But let me give you something to think about. The last few years of the 20th century are going to demand a lot more mental vigor and mental activity. The competition and complications of life are going to truly challenge the full capacity of our mentality. So, stretch your mind.
Do you ever think about what you think about? Because if you did, and if you took control of that, you could alter the direction of your entire life. Most people never take the time to take an inventory about their thoughts. Yet our thoughts control our world. Our thoughts are like magnets. They literally draw towards us that which we obsess about. And so most people never take the time to analyze what they think about. The most successful people I know are the most self-aware, meaning they're aware of what they do, and they're also aware of what they think. They're aware of how they're perceived. So today's message is about thinking. There's some stats you need to know. Number one is, Average person, you and I have about 75,000 thoughts a day rattling around in this thing we call our brains and our minds. 75,000 of them. The crazy thing is 91% of those thoughts are identical to the previous day and are identical to the day before that and the day before that and the day before that. And then we wonder why our life seems to repeat itself over and over again. So really the difference in our life, if we have 75,000 thoughts a day, here's the crazy thing. 91% of them are exactly the same. The separation in our life is in those 9% of their thoughts. Because remember this, these magnets are pretty powerful. That's why I'm always saying that your obsessions become your possessions, because they do. You draw into your life exactly what it is you think about. It's a physical reality that you attract to yourself what you think about. So the difference in our life is 9% of our thoughts. That's why people say all the time, the difference between winning and losing is so small, it's almost too scary to talk about. And really, we've identified what it is. It's 9% of what we think about alters the direction of our life. So what I'm here to tell you today is you've got to hone in and get aware of what you think about and then alter those 9% of the thoughts that are variable on a daily basis to serve you. Because if you don't, these thoughts become like viruses. They're viruses in our mind. What happens in a computer when it gets a virus? It slows down. It becomes sluggish. It doesn't function at its optimal level. Same thing with our thinking. If we don't get those 9% of our thoughts to serve us, our lives go in a completely different direction. So remember this. You don't see things in your life as they are. You see things in life as you are. And so the more you alter you, the more you begin to see things differently. What's amazing about this is we control who we are by what we think about. Think about this just for a second. Wherever you're sitting watching this, the chair that you're sitting in, if you're sitting in a chair, if you're driving in a car and you're listening to this, that seat you're in started in someone's mind as a thought, right? Every detail of it, the fabric, the cushions, the way it's structured, every single piece of that started in someone's mind as a thought and then became a reality by putting out the pieces together. See, everything in life is that way as well. It always begins with a thought. When we think a new thought, here's what literally happens. Thinking a new thought literally opens a space up in our minds, in our lives, that never existed before prior to having that thought. It's like a brand new space you've created just by thinking it. And what happens is your unconscious and subconscious mind goes to work on filling in that space with the people, places, resources, and things to fill it up like a room in an architect would, to fill up that space and fully furnish it. That's the power of how we think. So literally everything that exists started as a thought in someone's mind and then became a material matter. And so you've got to begin to think about the things you want to materialize in your life on a regular basis and think about it repetitiously. Literally the things that we obsess about become the things that we possess in our lives. Most people, those variable 9% of their thoughts is the new thing they're worried about, the new fear they have, the new response to an email they have to make, and they never dictate the terms. Remember this, your mind is a weapon. And you got to begin to use it and pick that weapon up and control it. Most people are out of control with their mind. They don't point it at something. They let the world point it and they misfire all the time.
Get back up. That's what life is about. Get knocked down, but not staying down. Taking in that air, breathing in that life, but having the ability to getting back up. Circumstances are happening every single day in people's lives. And some things they just don't have control over. Not you, not me, not anyone. But nevertheless, we must have the ability to get up. You can be rejected. You can feel alone. Your relationships are bad. Things are not working out the way you want them to work out. But you still have to have the ability to get up. You must be strong enough and willing enough to understand the circumstances that are happening in your life must happen and it will happen, but you don't stop going forward. You don't let distractions or anything disrupting your ideas and your dreams and your life. Your life is beautiful. Regardless of the hurts, regardless of the setbacks, regardless if you get knocked down, you got to have the ability to get up. A lot of people want to give up. A lot of people are hopeless. But what are you? Are you going to fit in that category? Do you feel that you need to be that type of person? Do you feel that you are hopeless? Or do you have enough faith and enough hope within your heart and your soul to carry on? Don't give in to the circumstances that you feel that are holding you down. Sometimes you got to go through the pain so you can understand what a real victory is all about. A lot of people want easy. A lot of people want to celebrate a victory. But what victory have you earned if you haven't suffered? Don't be that individual. Stand on what you got to do and go after it. Being knocked down. How many times have we heard, I'm at the end of my rope? How many times have we heard, I don't have any hope? How many times have we heard, I don't have no faith? How many times have we heard, I can't? How many times have we heard, I'll try it? How many times have we heard, I can't? The can't do nothing for you anyway. So why hold on to it? Why believe in it? Why trust in it? Why give can't so much power? Why give excuses so much power? Why can't you just decide the fact and understand that there's something that is unique and beautiful about you?